Port Royal Sound is unique. The largest ships in the world could sail into Port Royal Sound, and that's what Jean Ribaut, the French explorer, said. She said all the ships of France, nay, all the ships of the world, could safely ride in its bounds. It's very deep and very unusual, and if you're a sailor and you go up and down the coast on the Inland Passage, you come into Port Royal Sound, you know it's different. You can smell it. It's 60 feet deep in the middle of Port Royal Sound, 30 feet deep over the bar. And the interesting thing to me is that the shape of the entrance has not changed for 500 years.
Millions of shells, left by native inhabitants over thousands of years, attest to the bounty of its waters. Clovis points, which are more than 10,000 years old, have been unearthed on its shores. Inevitably, the natural riches of the sea islands surrounding Port Royal Sound attracted the great empires of the 17th and 18th centuries. First, Spain arrived in 1521. Then France came ashore in 1562. Finally, the British claimed them as Carolina in 1663. The land of Charles. After barely surviving a deadly clash with the Native Americans, the settlers demanded protection from the colonial government. Their log fort in Beaufort Town had been burned. They felt defenseless.
And it was in that early period, in this early 1720s, that the people of Beaufort said, "We need a fort to protect us." So they built this to protect the Inland Passage before it got to Beaufort, which is the reason for the location of what eventually became Fort Frederick or Fort Prince Frederick.
The new fort began to take shape in 1726 after the famous settler Colonel John Barnwell, better known as Tuscarora Jack, returned from England with the Independent Company afoot, a regiment of British regulars. For the next 7 years, Fort Prince Frederick, a small structure measuring just 125 feet by 75 feet, existed as a typical frontier-style log and earthen fort. Artillery stood at the ready to slow any approach by the Spanish fleet. As soon as the first warnings from the watch cannons at the mouth of the sound were fired, the militia would be dispatched. Still, the settlers of the islands envisioned something sturdier, a structure that could offer them real protection in times of trouble.
The people kept petitioning the Commons House Assembly and the colonial government for more money to finish the fort and build it more stoutly.
In 1773, the French Huguenot settler and contractor, John de la Baire, was hired to devise a more substantial structure.
And he said, "I'll build a fort of oyster shell and lime," which is what we see there today. And he built the fort, and as it was described in 1733, it was 5 feet thick and 5 feet high. That's pretty stout.
The fort was named for the eldest son of King George II of England.
So Fort Prince Frederick, which is his formal name, was built in 1726, completed in 1733, probably abandoned by 1740. It had that short a history. And for the first 7 years of its existence, 1726 to 1733, it was the southern frontier of English North America.
And although the British occupied Port Royal for a time during the American Revolution, the greatest battle waged by Fort Prince Frederick over the next century and a half was one with the weeds and the weather. A planter by the name of John Joyner Smith came into possession of the land early in the 1800s, turning the expanse above the old fort into fields of cotton tended by the enslaved. But all that changed in November of 1861, when Union forces overcame the Confederate territory.
When the Battle of Port Royal Sound happened in the fall of 1861, and the planters from the Beaufort region skedaddled, as they call it, they left behind between 8 and 10,000 slaves.
The people were so jubilant when they heard the cannons go off, because there were about 55 ships coming into that area, that they called it Big Gun Shoot Day. And when they when they heard the big gun shoot, they said, freedom is here, the Yankees are here, so we're free.
But that area on those bluffs above Fort Frederick is where there'll be camps, again, throughout the war. And there'll be everything from artillery to infantry encamped, both white and black troops throughout the area. They will build a pier over top of the walls of Fort Frederick out into the Beaufort River.
Over the top of old Fort Frederick stepped the 1st Black Regiment, mustered in as the 1st South Carolina of African descent.
It's going to be in the summer of 1862. Everything sort of begins to change, and permission is given to begin raising black regiments at that time.
President Abraham Lincoln sent a military governor to Port Royal.
General Rufus Saxton is given permission to begin raising upwards of 5,000 black troops. And one of the first things he does is he orders them to assemble at the Smith Plantation, and that will become their camp, and eventually it will be named Camp Saxton in his honor.
Dozens of missionaries, teachers, and physicians from the northeast part of the U.S. arrive in South Carolina to begin a project that will come to be known as the Port Royal Experiment. They are joined by the famed Harriet Tubman, who brought many people to freedom with the Underground Railroad. She nursed the Civil War injured, while she showed the newly freed people how to willingly work in a wage-based system, rather than being forced to labor under the threat of the lash. Miss Laura Towne established the Penn School on St. Helena Island, just a ferry ride across the Sound from Fort Frederick, an institution that is still in operation today. Lincoln watched the experiment with great interest, and during the summer of 1862 announced the preliminary Emancipation Proclamation. Immediately, plans were made for an elaborate celebration at Camp Saxton for January 1, 1863, the day the proclamation was to be signed.
And it's very elaborate. They were roasting 10 oxen and preparing tables for 4,000 or 5,000 people to come down to it.
Of course, when it was read and after it was read, someone spontaneously popped out with the song, "My Country, 'Tis of Thee," and jubilation took place. But the Emancipation Proclamation was a high point in their lives at that time.
When the Emancipation Proclamation was read, they used that fort as the base for their dock. You know, and the dock was built over the top of the fort, and boats came in. But there it was. I mean, at ground zero of that event. And that event is as significant an event as ever occurred in 500 years of history of this county, certainly, and one of the most important events in the state's history.
A devastating hurricane shook the Sea Islands in 1893, causing massive damage. More than 2,000 people died. Yet the sturdiness of the 5-foot-tall and 5-foot-wide walls saved the fort from annihilation. Today, it still stands as the oldest tabby structure in South Carolina. In the winter of 2015, archaeologists worked to excavate the remains of Fort Frederick in preparation for the day when it will be accessible to the public by land for the first time in many years. Old Fort Frederick is also being given a new layer of tabby in preparation for its future as the one remaining ambassador to witness a pivotal historical event. The fort's most important job, as it turned out, was to serve as the actual bridge from the waters of Port Royal Sound, supporting people as they step toward their celebration of freedom.